Are you ready for God's word this morning? Stand with me for the reading of God's word. We're going to go to Galatians chapter 5, and we're going to start, chapter 3, and we're going to start reading with verse 5, and we're going to jump all the way down to verse 18. Do you have your Bibles there? If you're ready, say amen. Amen. Verse 5 says, "Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Just as Abraham believed God, it was accounted to him for righteousness. Therefore, know that those who are of faith are sons of God. Of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles," I love the King James word here, he calls them heathen. Y'all don't know any heathens, do you? That was a rhetorical question. "Therefore, know," verse 7, "therefore, know that only those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. And the scripture," did I skip a verse? No, I didn't. Okay. Verse 8. "And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all nations shall be blessed." Somebody say blessed. "So then, who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham." Verse 10. "For as many are the works of the law are under the curse." For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. "For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them." 13. Underline it, circle it. "Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. It is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit." How? Through faith. 15. "Brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant. Yet, if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. Now to Abraham and his seed." Someone say capital S. "Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds. As of many, but as of one. And to your seed, who is Christ." 17. "And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed beforehand by God in Christ, that it should make the promises of no effect. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise." Father, thank you for this word. Thank you for who you are in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone shouted, amen and amen and amen. You may be seated this morning. We are talking about the blessing. And in order to understand what's happening here in Galatians chapter 3, we have to understand what God was doing in the life of Abraham. If you have your Bibles, we're going to flip over to Genesis chapter 12. And I want to read the first three verses. Genesis chapter 12, the first three verses. Let me get there. Media team, do we have that? Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. This is God speaking to Abraham. Who is making Abraham the great nation? God. Who is blessing Abraham? And I will make your name great. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. Verse 3. And I will bless those who bless you. And I will curse him who curses you. And in all the families of the earth, and in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. All right. In order to understand what God said to Abraham, we've got to go all the way back to Genesis chapter 1. Don't go there. If you're taking notes, just write down Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. God said to Adam and Eve, be blessed and multiply and take dominion over the earth. Not only everything on the earth, but the fish in the sea. Everything belongs to you. So when God blessed Adam and Eve, God literally gave them the keys to 100% absolute authority in the earth realm. So what did God give Adam and Eve when he blessed them? It is the Hebrew word barak. And it is provision without toil. I'll say it again. It is provision without toil. How did God create? He said a thing. He said he saw. He said he saw. He said he saw. Seven times he said and saw. He said and saw. When he created man out of the dust, he blew into Adam and said, poof, and Adam became a living soul. Adam became the general manager of the entire earth, the weather, the creatures, the plants, everything. Adam had complete authority on the earth. God put inside the man the mind of God. Adam was the man. And God blessed Adam and Eve with the ability to say and see. As a matter of fact, God placed them in a place of provision. They didn't grow a single thing. They tended to the provision that was provided. And every time they stepped out of the Garden of Eden experience in a dry desert place, all they had to do was open their mouth and say a thing, and the dry desert place became the Garden of Eden experience again. What's the experience? It's the provision without the toil. Now, I didn't say without work. Because we have to cooperate with God. God puts a thing in our mind and we have to carry it out in obedience. But there's a difference between your purpose motivating you, and you can do that all day, all night. And when you're in the glory of God, you do not even get tired. Do you know, this may shock some of the religion out of you, Adam was never created to die. He was created to live forever. The glory of God was so thick on Adam that when he created high treason and gave the authority away, the devil didn't steal it. The serpent didn't steal the authority to manage the place and to run the place from Adam and Eve. Adam gave it away. Let me help you. When God saw this, and he said, Adam, where are you? And they were hiding, remember? God knew where they were physically. He wasn't asking them, where are you in the garden? He knew, but he saw that they were not in the position of authority where he had left them. They had given the authority away. That's why he asked the question, who said you were naked? We're clothing ourselves because we're naked. Well, how do you know? Because in the glory of God, when you're the head, it doesn't matter. You don't pay attention to stuff like that. All you're doing is what God created you to do. And that's to rule and reign, take dominion, multiply. Everything was under the instruction of Adam, the man on the earth, even in the water. The Bible says it. It's right there in Genesis chapter 1, 28. So we know Adam gave away the authority, the barak, because it's the same word in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. And God blessed them. Same word. So then we move forward and we look at the word barak again. So we know Adam, and for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, Adam lived on the earth. Why? Because he was created in the glory of God. And it took that long for the glory to run out. You can't experience death in the glory. I'm teaching you something. I can. So God gave Adam the authority. Adam gave it away. Then you flip over to Genesis chapter 9. God had a man named Noah. It's interesting. The Bible uses the exact phrase. And God blessed Noah and his sons and told them, have dominion in the earth, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Same blessed. Barak is provision without toil. How many of y'all would like to have provision without toil? So then you're looking there at Genesis chapter 9, verse 1. God blessed Noah and his sons. We step back up here to Genesis 12. And we know that God blessed Abraham. This is where it gets interesting and exciting for me and you. Because when God blessed Abraham, what did he say? He said, Abraham, get out of this country and get away from your family. Now, Abraham's not a very good listener. Because if you'll get down past verse 3 in chapter 12, if you get down past that, the Bible says that Abraham gathered his immediate family, and then he took Lot, and then he took some, you know, Sissy and Ray Ray and Boo Boo and all them, and that's not what God said to do. How many of y'all know that sometimes you can feel like you're doing what God told you to do, have the right attitude about it, but the wrong help me, Father. The right attitude, but you're going the wrong direction. God didn't say take your family with you. God said leave your family behind. Why is that? Because not everyone in your family is going to be supportive of these things God's telling you. I'm telling you a thing right now. Your family is not going to have ears to hear what God has said to you. Matter of fact, God said it to Abraham. Abraham went and carried it over to Sarah. He said, come on, baby, we're packing. Where are we going? I don't know, but God said he's going to show me. By the way, get Lot. Get them all together. Tell them we're leaving. That's not what God said. God said, get your family, get going. Get out of here. Because he said, I'm going to bless you. Watch. He said, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I, God, said to Abraham, I will make you a great nation. I will barak you. Bless. I will give you provision without toil. Same word. Same word. And we know that Abraham was incredibly blessed. As a matter of fact, when Abraham understood giving, he was the first to tithe to Melchizedek. And his tithe would have broke most churches. It was massive. Because he was blessed, God said he was going to do it, and God did it. See, when God says, I'm going to bless you, you can take it to the bank, whether nobody else believes it or not. God's going to bless you. You and I are blessed. God said he was going to do it. He blessed Abraham. Now, we know Abraham, as most of us do, we try to figure it out. We get flesh in the way. How many of y'all remember the hookup between him and Hagar? Hagar was the mistake. That was Abraham having a conversation with Sarah, and Sarah said, baby, look, I'm old. Ain't no way this happening through me, but I got a servant girl over here. Her name's Hagar. Maybe what God meant was you and her hook up, and that's where that's going to come through. And Abraham's like, are you sure, baby? I mean, I'll take one for the team. How many of y'all know sometimes when you think you're helping God out, you are way off base? And so now we've got Ishmael who is born. And all of a sudden, Sarah's pregnant years later. And now Ishmael looks like Abraham, talks like Abraham, acts like Abraham, being raised in Abraham's house. And along comes Sarah one day and says, hey, baby, guess what? We're going to have a baby. Abraham's like, yay. And along comes Isaac. Watch. Now we have the miracle and the mistake living in the same house. One day Sarah's doing the dishes. I'm taking some liberties in scripture here. She looks out the window and she sees Ishmael making fun of Isaac. How many of y'all know Mama Bear rose up and said, Abraham, I don't care where they go, but they can't stay here. Pack them a lunch, give them some water. Hagar and the other boys got to go. Do you all know that when you're trying to live with the miracle and the mistake in the same place, at some point in your life, you've got to learn to say goodbye to the mistake? You've got to let it go. You've got to send your mistakes packing. Even though it looks like you, acts like you, walks like you, probably talks like you, and it's connected to you, you've got passion for it, you've got love for it. But I'm going to tell you, the mistake and the miracle can't dwell in the same dwelling. And mature. This is good. Why am I telling you this? Because I want you to know that Abraham went through some stuff and he was still called blessed by God. So we know what happened. Hagar, just so you know, Hagar and Ishmael, they left. Abraham sent them packing. Ishmael, the great nation of Palestine. Palestinians come from that lineage. Just let me help you with something. If you're following along in the Middle East, there will be no peace in the Middle East between the Jews and the Palestinians, because the Hebrew line came through Isaac, Abraham, and Sarah. The Palestinian line came through Abraham and Hagar, through Ishmael. In the Jewish culture, the firstborn gets daddy's stuff and a double portion of it. So the Palestinians believe that Ishmael was the firstborn to Abraham. Israel's their land. Technically, they got a point, but that's not what God said. God said, I'm going to bless you through you and Sarah. The miracle came through Isaac. So that's why the Jewish people are in the land today. That's why the Hebrew nation and the Palestinian nation are going to be fighting till Jesus comes, because they both think they own the land. I don't care if his name's Trump or Bates. Not a president on the planet going to bring peace to that country. And when I didn't mean to get here, but I'm here, let me say it. And so when the Antichrist rises up out of the Middle East, could be Syria in that area geographically, he's going to bring peace for 7 years. But we're going to be gone. Won't be any peace. There can't be. They've been battling this for thousands of years. And we show up, come on, let's see if we can bring peace. Your Bible says when they cry out for peace and safety, sudden destruction shall come. That generation shall not pass until we see the second coming of the Son of Man. I believe we're there.
So now we get over to Galatians. Now we get over to Galatians chapter 3. And God says, I have a seed from the line of Abraham. Do you know that we're talking about Jesus? Jesus was the seed that God is talking about here. And the Bible says that now the heathen nation, which is the Gentiles, just so you know, there's no black and white in the kingdom of God. The only race there is in the kingdom of God is Jew and Gentile. Is my mic on? So when God looks down, he doesn't see red, yellow, black, and white, brown. He sees Jew or Gentile. That's all he sees. And so God looks down and says, this journey, this covenant that I made with Abraham had nothing to do with the law of Moses. He said, I made a promise to Abraham that through his seed, that through him, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. What does all mean in Scripture? And so now we get here to the Galatian passage of Scripture, and he's preaching that through Abraham, Abraham had faith to believe God. Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Because Abraham believed God, he put him in right standing with God. Even though Abraham made all of his mistakes, and Abraham lied about his wife being his wife, and all these mistakes that he made with Hagar and Ishmael and all the stuff, God still said, I'm going to bless Abraham's seed, that through that seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. And then the Bible says that Jesus came through that lineage, and I don't have time to go through the genealogy. Just know that Jesus is the seed of Abraham. And all of us Gentiles, us non-Jewish people who believe in Jesus because of what Jesus did on the cross, all the blessings of Abraham through the generational blessing, all the way down to Jesus. Now for those of us who come after Jesus, if we will put our faith in what Jesus has done, you and I get to participate in the blessings of Abraham. We are blessed, and it's got nothing to do with you. It was a covenant that God made years and years and generations ago. And now by faith, You and I who are sons and daughters of God. Any sons and daughters in the room? Well, how did you get here? You got here by faith. We are saved by grace through faith in what Jesus has done. Do you know that you're blessed? I mean, do you really know that you are blessed? Because when you truly know, your Bible says back in Genesis chapter 12, God looked at Abraham and said, I am going to bless those who bless you. And I'm going to bless you so that you can be a blessing. Barakah in the Hebrew. Blessing is the result of knowing how to live in and operate in provision without toil. How come it feels like I'm trying to get 12 feet deep in the kiddie pool right now? This is a fantastic revelation. You are blessed with effortless, toilless provision. You still have to cooperate with God. You operate in obedience. But do you know you could open your mouth and say a thing and you'll see a thing? Jesus did. He said he saw, he said he saw, he said he saw. That was the blessing. Look at your neighbor and say, I am blessed. Look at him again and say, and so am I. Oh, we sing it right. I am blessed. I am blessed every day that I live. I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed. And we look like we've been sucking on lemons all afternoon. Do you know you're blessed? It was God that told Abraham, I will bless you. You keep looking for a man to bless you. You keep looking for a ministry to bless you. You keep looking for an employer to bless you. I came today to tell you that the blessing of God came from God to you. You carry that blessing, and your employer has no choice but to be a blessing to you because of God, not because of man. That blessing kept going forward. It went from Adam to Noah to Abraham, ended up on a kid named Joseph. Joseph literally sold into slavery by his brothers because he had a blessing. He had the blessed anointing on his life. God showed that kid stuff. He shared it with the wrong people, ended up in a pit. Be careful what you share with people around you, because not everyone's going to be as excited about your blessing as you are. Joseph said, I see everybody bowing down to me. God's going to elevate me. His brothers were like, he's already daddy's favorite. Let's kill him. No, let's not kill him. Let's just take him out, throw him in a pit until daddy, he died. Watch. The blessed anointing was on Joseph's life. I'm fast forwarding through here for the sake of time. But by the time they finally got Joseph in the pit, months earlier, a caravan just happened to be released of Ishmaelites. Months earlier. So they just happened to be coming by the pit at the exact time Joseph was thrown in the pit, and just happened to be that they get in the pit and pull him out, sell him into slavery. The provision was on its way before Joseph ever ended up in the pit. Why? Because Joseph was blessed. Provision's already coming before you even know you need a way out. It's the same word. Blessed. Do you know you're blessed? Do you know your provision has already been provided for? God's a God of covenant. He's a God of promise. He made a promise to Abraham. He kept his promise through Jesus. And now, every promise God ever made Abraham belongs to you. Kara, I honestly thought they were going to receive this message. Some of y'all are looking around at your circumstance and you're trying to view this message through the scope of your circumstance. How can I be blessed? I'm dealing with. Ask Joseph. He was dealing with some stupid stuff too. Some stupid people too. Falsely accused too. He didn't get to the palace from the pit. He had to go in and he went through the prison systems and then he went into some other false accusations and we know all that. He found favor everywhere that he went. Do you know that Joseph, everywhere he went because of the blessing, he ended up running the place wherever he went, because you can't stop what God has blessed. God told Abraham, I will bless you. Somebody say, God did it. And what God has blessed, man cannot get in the way of, unless it's you. You can stop the fulfilling of a thing by doubt and unbelief. If you're throwing more pity parties than you are rejoicing parties, you've missed it. You are blessed. You ought to be waking up every day going, I am blessed. I am blessed every day that I live. Oh, I am blessed. Devil, guess what? I woke up this morning and I'll lay my head to rest because I am blessed. Oh, I am blessed. Everything God promised, he'll never turn his back. God keeps his promises. You are blessed. Whether you receive it or not, you are. You are blessed. How you doing today? I just prefer you say, by faith, I'm blessed. Do you believe it? On this side of the cross, when I say be blessed, it is a perpetuation of the blessing. The blessing never runs out. And if you truly grab a hold of that, your money won't determine how blessed you are. Because blessed is not just about your bank account size. It's a condition of your attitude. I know some millionaires that are suicidal. It's true. How you doing today? I'm blessed. My buddy Rich Bruce says, I'm blessed and highly favored. Are you? Absolutely I am. My blessing irritates the demons. How do I know? Because it manifests in people. Amen. Your blessings will imitate the demonic spirits that are operating in people's lives. It shows up in criticism. Well, I don't think they ought to. Be careful. Keep your mouth off of their blessing and put your mind on your own. Do you know you're blessed? If you know you're blessed, wave at me like this. You just know you're blessed. Amen. That's great. Now, we receive this by faith. This word faith is the Greek word pistis. This word pistis is the conviction that God exists and he's the creator and ruler of everything. He's the provider and bestower of eternal salvation through Christ. How do we tap into this faith or this blessing? By faith. We believe that God provided it all and he gives it away freely. How do we tap into this? We come into proper alignment with what Jesus did. Jesus is the doorway. He's more than just fire insurance. He's your access to every blessing God has for you, because God is a covenant God. God made a covenant with Abraham. Look at your neighbor and say, this ain't got nothing to do with me or you. God did it through Abraham. And now, because Jesus is the seed of Abraham, not seeds as of many, He's the seed. Now you and I, who are in Christ Jesus, we get to participate as Gentiles, heathens, participating in the promise God made Abraham. Do you know God never changed his mind? I am blessed. I am blessed. I hope y'all just sing this song all day. Hope you sing this song all week. Hope it just gets down into your spirit. And just, you begin to nurture that thing. Because you are blessed. I don't care what your circumstances say, you are blessed. That's the blessing of God. And he has blessed you to be a blessing. You are the pass-through. If your attitude will be, Father, I just want to be a blessing, and mean it, because there are some people, I just want to be a blessing, and somehow they've not been able to get the Velcro off their fingers. And they hang on to everything that God has blessed them with. I'm not talking about money. I'm just talking about everything. This is good. It was God that made him famous. It was God that blessed his seed. It was God that blessed him in everything that he did. God said, I will bless you. And when God says a thing, take it to the bank, baby. You can't stop it. Your circumstance, I don't see anywhere in Scripture where Joseph was like, you said I was blessed, and how did I get here? You know, like some of our prayer life. You know what Joseph said? I'm blessed. I've seen a thing. I've dreamed a dream. Daddy spoke to me something. And so while I'm here in the prison, I might as well run the place. And while I'm right here with Potiphar, I might as well run the place. Might as well keep operating in my gifting no matter where I am, because I'm blessed no matter where I am. That blessing is transferable. It goes with me. It doesn't stop at the state line. It doesn't stop at the door of the church. It goes with me wherever I am. So wherever I am blessed. And it doesn't matter what circumstance I'm dealing with. I can still deal with false accusation and trouble and all the stuff from a position and an attitude and perspective of being blessed. I don't know why this happened. I don't know how I got here. All I know is that I'm blessed and highly favored by God. So I'm going to look at this from Daddy's perspective. And God will elevate you in the prison so that you can get to the palace. And then all of a sudden, he goes from the prison to the palace. Now he's prime minister. He's running the place. And guess what happens? The dream that he dreamed as a kid, because of the blessing, saw him through everything, including when his family turned against him. People lied. If y'all ever had that, don't wave. But the blessing didn't stop the blessing. The blessing just kept flowing. Be careful who you tell your dreams to. One day his brothers come and bow before the prime minister, and Joseph's like, come here, fellas, I want to show you who I am. The dream came to pass, didn't it? Now, some of us, we don't like the detours. We're so used in this culture. We're so used to fast internet, fast computers, fast cars, fast food. Hurry up, we got to be out of church. Come on, preacher, you got about an hour of my time. Get to it. Just get to the point. One lady told me that years and years and years ago. She came up to me, and she'd had a stroke years before, and the filter between her mouth and her brain was broke. And she came up to me after church one Sunday. She said, I love the way you preach. It's just get to the point. I got to go. She just said what some think, I guess. I don't know. Come on now, preacher, we got to go. You're lucky I'm even here. I got to got to beat the Baptist over at the Golden Trough. Let's go. Wrap this up. Need a wrap-up box right here. No, man. We need to understand the blessing. digest this. You're blessed. Even when you don't feel blessed, you're blessed. Because you are blessed.